December 6th, 2016. You got somebody here to give a blessing, Kevin?
Yes, I can. Dear Heavenly Father, we'd just like to thank you for this day and guide this council and this mayor and all the employees to a wonderful Merry Christmas, and just guide us to do the best we can. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, additions to the agenda?
I have two short ones. One is on the overhead door at the plant, and the other one is an update on the Elster meeting.
Put that under you, Austin?
Yeah, please.
Anybody else? Citizen comments?
Someone has to approve.
Oh.
Second.
I didn't make a motion.
All in favor?
Move.
Second.
Second. Second over there. All approved? All opposed? 4-0. Citizen comments? If we get any citizens' comments, that means we have no unhappy citizens. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Consent agenda. Approved minutes. Regular council meeting, November 15th, 2016. Appropriation ordinance 12-6 of 16 for $86,626.79. Approved two invoices for prior year encumbrance funds, which was over the authorized spending authority. HD Supply, 23-9-8-21 for auto meter readings, and Bob's Hauling Service for $3,039.36 West Street repair.
Move to approve.
Motion to approve. Your second.
Second.
Got a second. All opposed. All four. 4-0. 3-0. 4-0. You got a vote for it.
I'm four.
You're four.
Yeah.
Solid waste contract for upcoming year, Unruh Brothers. I think we got a couple of them here.
Yep, two of them. All there is. I just gave you guys a few options there to look over. We'd like to make some changes. We don't know what you guys are comfortable with, but there's a few different options in there that I kind of come up with.
Has everybody looked at them?
No.
One of them is to raise the rate a dollar. And that is to compensate for the heavy, like the water and people not putting lids on their trash cans and stuff like that.
A dollar per household? Dollar
a dollar
per
a year?
A dollar per household. So instead of being $16, it'd be $17 plus our dollar $25. So each resident would be paying $18.
And I think whatever option you guys choose, we just have to do an amendment to the contract to make that precedence.
Okay. The second one is a $4 increase, but then Unruh Brothers would give everyone a 96-gallon trash can, and then they would reimburse the people that already have trash cans out there. So $4, and so you're looking at $21.25. A resident for that one. But everyone gets a trash can.
Do you pay that extra $4 a month until you pay off the trash can, or is that forever?
That's pretty much standard for basically forever. What I tried to do is work up a number with you guys for the 3-year contract that this pushes us into. At the end of that 3-year, of course, we can negotiate again. At that point, you guys would have grounds to stand on stating, hey, you know, sure, they're paid for by now, you know, give us a little leeway. And that would definitely be an option. There is also an option in there for the city to purchase those trucks for each resident. And then you wouldn't have to worry about that. We'd stay, you know, at that. We'd go just up to dollar for to be 17.
Do you remember how heavy you guys are because of the rain? Wasn't there an issue?
On wet days, like a wet Wednesday, just Wednesday itself, we'll run anywhere from 12 to 14 tons. And on a standard Wednesday coming out of town, we run anywhere from 8 to 9 tons. So it's a pretty substantial difference.
It's a lot of people with broken.
Yeah. It is. And honestly, 85% of the town has cans that, if it does have a lid, it doesn't have a bottom in the can. So it's just kind of an issue we would like to resolve. I mean, it help make our job easier, and you'd notice a lot less trash blowing around also, because when they're full of water, you know, half full of water, that paper and stuff still blows out of the top, and we definitely don't bend over and pick all the...
there is a requirement that people have a, or maintain an air, I forget the exact language, an air tight or...
On the ordinance.
Fly tight. Yes.
What was it?
It's a fly tight.
Fly tight.
Lid that lid. Has to stay and it has to be a fly tight lid. The problem with the ordinance is that there's no penalty attached to it. So really, how would we keep
it? So there's really no way to back it up. So that's kind of what we've run into.
Which, I mean, we could amend the ordinance to make there be a penalty.
Well, I mean, we don't. There's a general penalty ordinance in the code book, so we wouldn't have to amend it, but it's like $500.
Yeah.
What are we looking at? If we were to go with option three and the city was to purchase these, what are we looking at price per?
You're looking at, there's 84, there's about 84 trash cans out there already. That means residents that already have trash cans. You're looking about 84 to 88. So you're looking at...
They purchased from
yeah. Okay. From them.
Okay.
You're looking on average, there's about 480 resident people that have trash service.
Right.
So if you take that number, you minus, you know, if, even if you say minus 80, you got 400 trash cans at $400 a piece.
Well, if you guys chose to do that, I kind of put this idea out there, you guys to find the options. If you guys as a city chose to buy the totes themselves, I could give you a discounted rate. It would probably be closer to about $85 a piece if you guys purchased that many at once. But that is our cost. I mean, we're basically handing that straight through to you guys on that situation.
It's going to cost more than that because you're going to have to refund them people that already bought.
Correct.
Right.
Then you have to think about the ones that have already complied and have already bought the trash cans.
Give them an option of buying or renting at a monthly rate.
We could do that. Yes. Yeah, we could do that. It'd take me, you know, a little time to figure out kind of what we have to do there.
And then the other option is if the city bought them, then you could make the customers buy them from the city. I mean,
or even the city could lease them out. It's the big thing with the city situation. I spoke with a few other towns that have done this, and another company that does this with a few towns, is once you split it up and you lease them or you sell them or you do a little of both, you end up running into the whole fact of, well, my trash was out last night, but it wasn't, as well as, well, I paid for mine, I haven't been leasing it. One of those kind of situations. And when somebody's leasing it, you're responsible to fix the lids. If they purchase it, then obviously they're responsible. And
my question with the city needs to hold personally.
Well, one of the things I did have a community member come up to me and ask how much that the totes were, and I came in and I checked, and LaDonna told me, and it was the option of paying in two payments, I think.
Yeah,
it was.
Right. Yeah.
Is there any way that if we were to go with that again, can we kind of break that up a little bit more, or?
Yes, the problem I have to have there is the totes go up on us continually, just a little bit at a time. You know, we'll get an 8% increase, we'll get a 3% increase order to order. We can't afford, obviously, to stock 500 at a time. Right. We usually order anywhere from 25 to 75, depending on our demand form. We're already, by taking two payments for the totes and the amounts that we buy them, we're already losing money because the second time, the $50, every time the city bills out any kind of item on the bill, it charges us $1.25.
Okay.
So we're basically selling the totes for $97.50 because it's $1.25 goes back to the city for putting it on the bill two different occasions. I'd be more than happy to break it up, you know, four times if we could do something with the price of it, but there again, you're kind of defeating your purpose. Right.
Yeah, because speaking with the one person I did, and then talking with a few other community members, they would be more than happy to purchase them. But they at $50, you know, per payment, it's not something that they can do. And they they asked if that was something that could be negotiated, and I said, well, we can always ask. The worst they'll say is no.
Yeah, and we could definitely, but it's you got to string it out so far, you know, to make before the number actually catches up for both sides.
Right.
We've had several people in town that, you know, the $100 card is not in their budget, and I completely understand that. And I've told them, hey, and LaDonna can vouch, we've gone back and credited them back, and they've gone and bought a $30 tin can from the hardware store.
Right.
And that's more than fine with us, as long as there's a lid.
Right.
But that there's 15% of town that is really working hard and wants to make do it right, and then there's 85% that just, they want to, but they just don't quite want to put up the effort.
Right.
So that makes it difficult for us as far as trying to get along with everybody.
Right. I don't know what the rest of you think, but sounds to me maybe option one is probably the most reasonable one that we can do right now for the community. Any thoughts?
I agree.
And with that option, I do want to push more this coming year to get, you know, containers up to what they're supposed to be.
Right. I think also, too, that we need to revisit the ordinance on this, and we need to put something on there that so people can become compliant. I mean, if we need, I hate to do it, but if we need to start fining people for not being in compliance, then we need to do that.
I was
out of compliance. I wouldn't bought one.
A flat fine. We can do a flat fine. And that would be the easiest way.
That would
way.
Be the easiest.
Yeah, you know, something that escalates.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No. The only other way to do it is like the picture they sent me the other day, where it could almost be a health ordinance or a health violation.
It really is.
I mean, that's the only way I can get to it. And so in that case, what we did is we sent a letter to both the resident and with the solid waste ordinance, and we sent it to the owner of the spot, just explaining, hey, you can't leave your trash this way. Otherwise, it's going to become a health
violation. You had mentioned that there's a kind of like a general fine.
There's any violation of the code is subject to a penalty of not more than $1,000 or imprisonment in jail more than 179 days, which we don't enforce ever because we just don't have that
kind of steep for not having a trash.
but at the same time, I use that. That's my general penalty for a lot of the dog stuff. That's my general penalty for almost any. It's kind of the catch-all. Something easy can be done that if it's a one-time violation, it's $1. If it's second time, it's in a six-month period, $15. You know, whatever you guys think. Enforcement, I think that just you guys could take a picture or take notes or something.
Say we got.
Yeah, we
got
would.
More
have,
pictures
I mean,
of
honestly,
kids on my phone right now.
We'd have to up our rate and have you guys buy us cameras and SD cards.
We would have to figure out some way of.
You'd have to find some way, because otherwise we wouldn't have proof.
It
we'd go back to the whole he said, they say, we say.
Yeah.
And that's what puts us in the spot. I mean, I don't know if you have city guys that can just drive your alleys. I mean, it's obvious the people that are not compliant. You can see it from the end of the street at the end of the alley. So it just puts us in a tight spot. You guys have really made us, you know, made our business, and we want to get along the best way we can.
Right.
But at the same time, it's awful uncomfortable reaching down and picking up bags from, you know, different households, not knowing what's in them. And taking that risk of them calling us in and complaining, or do we just pick it up and hope that everything works out for us?
Right. I think if we're going to institute a new fine on it, it needs to be steep enough that it kind of hurts people in the pocketbook, but not too bad where it's going to kill them. And so,
what if we put another letter in with our bills stating it before we do anything? And see if that will help any, and say if you don't get in compliance, we will have to fine you. See if that works.
Well, I think we need to have something in place to, before we do that. I mean, yeah, that's a great idea to do that, but we need to have something in place that says, you know, if you're not in compliance, then we're going to fine you X amount of dollars. You know, I mean, like I said, I don't want it to be too steep to the point where everyone starts coming in here and complaining. But at the same time, I want it to be enough that they're like, oh crap, I better not do that.
I'm gonna do it right, yeah.
You know, I mean, I know for me, if it was me, I'd be like, you know, 15, 20, 25 bucks. I'm gonna be like, I'm gonna make sure I've got it because I am not gonna spend 15, 20, or 25 bucks, you know, because I'm out of compliance. All right. So, I think what we need to do is just have John write something up, and we need to let him know how much it's gonna be. So I don't know what the rest of you think, but I think $20 would be a good start.
Probably Steve.
I think so. I don't want to spend $20 for being simply out of compliance when I could very easily have taken care of it.
Can I throw something out there for you guys? If you would go with the $21.25 a month, that's a $4 month increase. And Mark made the comment that somebody couldn't afford the $50 two payments for the containers. The $4 would eliminate the whole problem of being in compliance. Plus, everybody can afford the $4.
Well,
just food for thought.
Well, you know,
did I understand that right?
Yeah,
it would be $21.25. Right. It would be our $1.25 plus their $20.
Well,
but that's only a $4 increase from where we're at now.
Well, I can tell you right now, we're all going to get a lot of people complaining if we, you know, we raise it up. You know, I mean, I've already talked with quite a few.
Okay.
And I don't know about the rest of you.
Just food for thought.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, and I agree. But the thing is, we're, you know, we are going to get people who are going to come in here and they're going to come to us and they're going to start complaining. And they're going to, why are you doing this? You know, people, that's just the nature of the beast. People, I mean, we raise it a dollar, people are going to complain. I can already tell you that right now. They go, why are you raising it a dollar? You know, it's going to happen. You know, heck, if we raise it 25 cents, people start complaining. People are already complaining, oh, you kept my 25 cents. You know, put on it.
It's not me. I didn't keep it. It's by my soda.
Initially in that situation, you know, if people will complain.
Right.
Obviously, you know, especially in a smaller town like this. A positive side of that also is if you guys basically up the price and it's a continual charge monthly, if that lid breaks, if the latch breaks on the trash can, we take care of that stuff. Those lids are $25 a piece. Yeah. So there's going to be people that can actually get to us. You know, if it's broken and we replace the lid, there's $25. You know, there again, we're set back again trying to get those totes paid for.
Right.
So something to consider. You know, they have their own cans and somebody rolls out in the street, somebody runs over it, they're going to spend $25 buying another can just to stay in compliance, you know, buying a can from the lumberyard down here. So it kind of depends on how accepting, you know, the citizens are to getting ahead, you know.
Right.
So like Bob was saying, with the $4.25?
It's just $4, and then you got $1.25. So you're actually raising it.
Everybody gets a can, and you're going to make
right,
it.
Right, yeah. Right. As long as they don't set fire to it. You know, if the wind blows the lid open, and the latch breaks, things like that, we'll take care of that.
Yeah, you see it this week, you're going to bring it with you next week.
Right, exactly. Well, within a day or two. We're down here at least 2-3-4 times a week.
Because we've already called our cart guy, and if we get the order in before the end of the year, we can have them at the end of December, you know, have them hopefully all set at the first part of the year. But if we wait till January, it'll be, I think he said March before he'd be able to get that big of an order in because so many people are getting that first quarter deal.
So what about the people that have more than one?
That becomes an issue where...
I know. You guys can just look at me. I want to know, what are you going to do with my three?
The rate would be, what you do in a situation like that, what we would do is you would just own the other two yourself, and your rate would still be the $20 or the $21.25 with the city's cut.
I'm not the only one that has three.
No. And basically, by buying that trash can, you know, you kind of pay for some of the extra weight anyway. I mean, we're trying to be reasonable.
Commercial dumpster? What do you do?
Three or under five?
You have six people that live in my house.
Oh, and sometimes they're full.
Trust me, they're full. And I call Grant and I tell him, hey, you know, I'm
Takes
sorry.
Takes us 2 weeks to fill ours.
No. Just come over to Garcia's house.
Comes in town, rents a house, and stays here for 3 months, gets a trash container, and then just leaves town, takes the container with them. I mean, you're just
that's kind of our risk at that point. I mean, we could go take action if we felt necessary to really push it. That's part of why it's $20 a month instead of $15. You know, we've got to have some kind of
sure.
And we're, you know, if you guys would allow a longer period of contract or a, you know, if you like us do a 3 year and then follow up with a 5, like we did the 1 with the 3 this time. That helps soften it for us, and we can sit down at a later date. You guys can call us out, and maybe we can negotiate to bring the price down once our expense, our initial expense, is out of the way. So I mean, I'm gonna stay here until you guys kick us out. So,
well, that's what I would like to see is only in here every 5, and the only thing you can do is a fuel surcharge or whatever.
Right.
If something goes up.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, really, the fuel is kind of in waste hauling. The fuel is kind of on the hauler. We do more of a economic or a landfill increase is when we can
somewhere
fuel. We just kind of eat it. That's just.
So I just
just need a motion on which one you guys want.
Well, that's, yeah, one of you guys, I mean, I call on mine to dump stuff. I don't use it. I'm going to pay it. I mean, you're going to charge me at my house for the extra $4 increase, but I don't use it, right?
With yeah, it's still beyond however the city bills
and,
that.
And I already paid close to 20 anyways with my three dumpsters, so it doesn't matter.
I'm in the same, I take mine to the big dumpster.
Yep.
So what are we looking at? Which option? I mean, I thought option one.
You're really looking, you're probably looking at the two that make the most sense is probably option one and option two.
Right.
I don't think you guys want to go into purchasing trash cans.
Right.
I mean,
well, I just wanted to find out a little information on that myself, but yeah.
I'm kind of in favor of option two.
Yeah. Option two does sound good. Yeah. I don't
like Bob said, it fixes your problem, but not
right.
Tell anybody.
Right.
Yeah, we don't have to say the attorney, maybe.
We're going to get some complaints, but I agree. I think that option two is probably the best.
Mark, you think the complaints would come from the same people that's having trouble buying the dumpsters?
Could be. It might be more. Who knows? It's hard to tell. With the people I've talked with, they're going to complain regardless.
See, we're going to receive scrutiny.
Yeah,
you guys are, and we are especially. Yeah, just because we're new, and here we go. We're racking it up. But honestly, if we can get them through 4 or 6 months, I really think that people would start to see the difference. I mean,
I like my trash.
But on another note, you know, we've never offered trash cans before.
Right.
As long as I've been on the council, we've never had trash
cans. Yeah, this is the first time I've seen it, so.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to go with option two. Are we doing this just with 1 year? Is this 1 year contract, or are we doing with
three?
This is 3 year. Okay, that's what I wanted to make sure. Yeah, that's fine with me.
Are there any kind of credit for those that used their 85 that purchased?
Yeah, there's about 84 trash cans out there, but there's three or four people that have more than one trash can. I mean, you have a total of about 84 trash cans out there.
Yeah. Same. We would reimburse everybody for one. If they bought two, then the second would still be theirs. And we would reimburse them for one. And that's how any company does this.
Grab them back at $4 a month, and then it softens that up.
But I would rather just have the whole lump sum.
You're talking about $10,000.
No, I mean, I'd rather just have them.
You're talking about almost $10,000.
We're not. He's going to buy it back.
Yeah, our initial investment's going to be of over $40,000. So.
Right. And that's pretty much what I figured, too.
And that's, you know, that's...
Are you going to reimburse them and they'll still pay the $4?
Correct. Okay. Correct. So then they're just like everyone else. I mean, it'll just be like everyone else. Yeah. But, like, I think mine with the three... I think I pay like $21 a month now for my three trash cans. So see, to me, it's not a big deal because I'm still paying.
Sure.
I mean, mine's still the same because I have three. I just have a trashy family.
What we'll need to do on that, I don't know how in depth you want to be on this right now, but the credit back would be around $85 to $90. You know, because by the time we had our delivery charge and everything on there with it, and then...
Well, and then the people have used them for like almost
right, and there's 30 of those that are actually, you know, roughly 30 that are used that only charge 50 to begin with, so they'll...
Yeah, I think Pam printed me a report that showed me how many used and how many...
Is there just one size of the container?
Yeah, they're all 95.
All 95?
Yeah. We can get smaller, but there you go. A wide array of options. It's just not what
I wasn't thinking smaller. I was thinking larger.
Yeah, 95 gallons is about as big as we can get.
Until you get into another
dumpster. Right.
Yeah. Say, so what is it? Two of those cans is considered almost a yard dumpster. A square yard, so.
Yeah. And so that, I mean, we could put a letter in there saying that that's why it's going to happen.
Do they wheel out real easy?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
we leave ours out all the time.
My mom's 94.
Sure. Well, and let me tell you something. If we have a can that's nice and we have to make a few steps and the whole town is abiding by this, we're going to be a lot easier to get along with when it comes to that kind of stuff. I mean, we already have some customers that have caught us and asked, hey, will you come up and get it? And we'll go to the, I mean, we'll go to the garage and pick it up. They don't have to bring it out or the back, you know, back steps. So
Kira can pull ours when it's full. She can just go and pull it. It pulls really nice. Granted, I just leave them out there on the
curb. I'm saying they're heavy enough that you can leave them set out there too and just take your trash to it. If they don't roll back like, forward.
That's what we do. No way. Oh, it's ugly.
They're really not that bad.
It's not sitting in my front yard.
No, it's not my front yard. It's in the back.
I don't have an alley.
Okay, I'm going to make a... make a motion to...
Well, let me. Do you want me to just bring all work, rework an amended contract?
Yeah.
And then you can adopt it then.
You want to just do that on the 20th?
Yeah, on the 7th. Kind of leave it just
to... Okay, yeah. All right, let's
and
do that.
And then that way...
All right, that works.
Yeah. And like I said, just remember, you know, coming up at the end of the year, it's going to be... We'll have, you know, 100 or 150 of them pretty quick off the bat, but we'll have to be at our manufacturer's...
Okay.
Discrepancy as far as getting the whole town set up. So it might be March but by the time we get all 400 into town. So just, you know, kind of keep that
okay.
Line.
Is you're not the $4 is not going to go on until the dumpster?
The 400 will start with the contract January 1st. We're just at this period of time with our vendors. I mean, they can't put out 500 totes between now and Christmas. It just won't happen.
Well, I think if any complaints, that would be probably a complaint.
A big one.
Yeah.
So you're charging somebody that don't have a new dumpster.
Right. And I understand that too. I mean, we could. I can make a call tomorrow and find out exactly how many I can have by December, and maybe we can do one side of town starts right away, and then the other side of town. I mean, that's kind of up to you guys. Whatever you think would work in that situation.
What's council think about that?
Yeah.
I can see why, I can see how that would.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just can't tell.
Okay, you have 100 green, 100 red, 100 blue, you know, but you guys probably would like to have a uniform trash can cover in town.
I mean, I'm not splitting hairs, but.
Yeah, they're definitely going to complain.
I agree with that. I agree with that. That's what I said. Kind of the time constraint here as far as making sure. I mean, if you guys will give me your word that that's what you're going to do, even without the contract set, you know, I'll get on it just as hard and fast as we can get them here. But I'm not going to sit here and say I can have everyone delivered by January 1 when I almost guarantee I can't.
Could there be a date in the future in which you could have all delivered on one date? We would start the $4 on
that
day. Say March.
Yeah, I could probably do that. I can get a hold of the vendor tomorrow.
And we can amend the contract and just say the $4 increase instead of start on a specific date.
February.
Yeah, why don't we do that?
I think we could probably eliminate some problems, guys.
Yeah.
Shoot for like the second
quarter. I mean, we haven't had a lot of complaints with the trash service since we changed,
right.
And I would rather keep it that way.
Right. Yeah. Right. Like I've told you in the past, the only complaints that I've gotten is you guys are working too hard.
Well, that's probably keeping some of the complaints down.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Hard work's never been a...
We'll keep that going.
A complaint.
Absolutely.
And in that, with us, you know, making the investment, I am going to ask that you guys put the rollover 5-year at the end of our 3-year. But there again, that is tentative to our performance throughout the 3-year period. You know, if you guys see fit... that we shouldn't have the 5-year, you know, we can't automatically push it on you.
Right.
But that gives us something to work towards, you know, it gives us a goal. So, versus an open bid come 2020.
Pretty good chance that 5 of us might not be sitting at this table.
Very possible. And that's why, if that's already in there, you know, that helps us.
There's 3 at least will be gone.
And that's standard. I mean, that's not something we're just doing. That's standard from several other companies I've talked with.
I would think that any council here, as long as there's no complaints, is not going to look very hard about changing.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would at least have much hope.
Yep.
Okay.
All right then.
Then we'll have that ready for next meeting, so you guys can have a couple of minutes. Because that would be the 20th.
Yep. Okay. Any other questions on the trash? Moving on down, department heads, grocery store task force report. Looks like we've got anybody here for
see
that.
You guys.
Thank you guys.
Grant administrator Lisa is not here. Police department, not here. Michael, not here. City clerk, LaDonna.
Not here.
Not here.
Not here. Oh, man.
Federal Labor Standard Act overtime rule.
So I'm sure you guys have all seen in the news that an injunction was put on the overtime rule. A federal judge in Texas has put an injunction on it and allowing it to, saying that no, it can't go in effect December 1. Which leads us to our next question, is that you guys did make a motion for those two raises. The motion will still stand unless somebody wants to take the motion away.
You know, it's like November 28th, the Federal District Court in Kansas, or I'm sorry, in Texas, ruled that the regulation increasing the amount, the threshold under the Fair Labor Standards Act, that $47,000,
right,
was an overstep of the Federal Department of Labor enjoined the government from enforcing that regulation. So it did not take effect in December 1. It's my understanding it's going to be appealed. It has not been appealed.
It will be appealed.
Obviously, if that's it's appealed, it won't have a retroactive effect because that would cause too many problems. But so you did not have to give the pay raise, but I guess is what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's not mandatory. But you guys did make a motion. So to take it away, you're going to have to make another motion. Now, do you want to know what the county's doing? The county's leaving the raises as they are. That's what they're just not even going to mess with it, and well, they're just leaving it.
Well, Donna and I argued about whether to put this on the agenda.
Yeah, after thinking about it, you know, we didn't really have it budgeted for 17.
No, the cushion's there, though, because I cushion the salaries high. So it's there.
The state doesn't know that.
But the state doesn't know that. No, you're absolutely right. The state doesn't know that. But I always cushion them high. Like mine, I think, is cushioned for 52 a year. For just salaries, 52,000 a year.
Oh.
And the police office is cushioned that high, too. And that's just in case something like this would happen, or just in case you guys would want to give that big of a raise. It was always 50, around the 50s, so we just left it in the 50s. So the money's there. But
it's possible that when the Trump administration takes over in January that they are not going to continue the appeal, which would leave the injunction in place. So that's the others. I mean, this isn't an issue for just the city. I mean, there's employers all over the place that have changed their accounting mechanisms and changed their pay structures completely, that have spent money doing that don't necessarily know what to do.
And when I emailed the league, and what they said was, it's really up to you guys. You guys made the motion to give the raises. Even though you thought it was mandated, now it's not mandated. To reverse it, you would have to make a motion to reverse it back.
I mean, basically, the only reason we gave the raise is because we thought it was going to be mandated. Yeah, it's just not because,
I'm the one that put it on the agenda. Mm-hmm.
Correct.
And so it was a total annual cost to us of just over $6,000?
$10,000.
Was it?
Between the two of them, it was like around $9,000 or so.
But there may be a lot of things over change when we change presidents.
Correct.
Yeah. From what it sounds like, I don't know. I know I got myself. I got papers yesterday, the day before, for counsel on the Blue Cross Blue Shield.
Are we going to discuss any employee performance on either two of those?
Well, if you want to, I mean, we can.
In the executive session?
No, but we can if you want to.
No, I was just checking.
No, I can.
But that's how
the paperwork has all gone through and it's all done, but I mean, if you guys make the motion, then we would.
You probably stayed late that night to get that.
gosh, we're going to get that in there.
You know, no, I did it the next day. Phone call before
I had already seen it. I had already seen it.
I heard it when I walked in the office that morning.
He knew the minute I walked in. Are you kidding me? So, really, that's the only way to take it away is if you guys choose to do that. then we need a motion to reverse it back.
If we leave it in place, what do we do? Not give them a raise forever?
I don't think Adams do for Adams. I think Adams raises. He just got one in September, and I think mine's in July. But I mean, yeah, you guys could stipulate that. You
decent
could,
raise all at once. Yeah, you know.
You could say that. You could say and
the only reason,
as being department heads, it's really Bobby who does the evaluations, and it's Bobby who gives the raise. So
it's up to you, Bob.
No, this isn't up to you. I was just trying to keep us out of trouble when I heard that was mandated.
I was too.
When I saw the papers. I thought it was an awful lot of raise at one time.
When do they usually give out raises for?
It's a yearly thing. Yeah. It's from when you get hired. It's your anniversary day. And the department, like Jeff and I and Adam, are the three that have to answer to the mayor. The rest of them are all done with
more salary.
Right. Everybody else, you have.
How many people in the courthouse did it?
Three. It affected three in the courthouse. I don't know how much, but Nita said that they weren't gonna go back. They were just gonna keep it. Her concern was if it did go further, and let's say the courts did go with the labor, the feds, then would they be out of compliance for that time if they didn't give them the raise? Would they go back and say, hey, now everyone that didn't do it, now you guys are all out of compliance? I mean, you just don't know what they're gonna say. So she said it was already a done deal and she was done, and she wasn't, her commissioners were fine with it, and they just didn't want to mess with it.
No.
That's pretty much what she said.
The other thing that needs to be considered is whether this is a retroactive change, or whether it's 6 days, or whether it's one pay period at the increased rate, since we're now at December 6th, and the raise took effect December 1.
Correct.
We can undo hers in October of 17.
Sure can. Unless the overtime rule passes by then.
Yeah, and do they know when that is?
I think the leak, Larry told me it might be months. You're talking like summer.
They don't overturn the injunction. You're talking could be years.
Yeah. He said we'd be lucky if it got done by summer, or at the end of summer.
I mean, I've got a case in federal district court, or federal, that's at the 10th Circuit now, that was 2009.
Yep. I moved to undo.
Second.
Is that effective December 1?
Yeah, they haven't received the money yet?
No, but it was effective December 1, so then you kind of have to, that's what he says, you know, are you going to go back and say, you're going to move it back as of December 1, so these 6 days.
And really, you have to check with
and I would have
person
to
see how that would work.
Yeah.
Assuming it can be done.
Would it be safer to undo it on January 1?
And you're effectively giving them a two or a month long.
A month long raise, and then you're going to take the raise away.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You basically knew you were getting it. And you.
They are. Adam and I already know.
I mean, I don't know.
Correct.
Haven't gotten it.
But technically, we haven't got the money yet.
Yeah.
I don't know when your payroll's processed and all that stuff, so I don't know.
First
of the 15th.
First of the 15th. So, I mean, it's in the system. So what she would have to do is she would have to refigure it. She would have to figure it for these 6 days, and then she would have to figure it again at the other lesser rate for the rest of it.
So moved.
Got a motion.
Figure it for 6 days, undo.
Got a motion on the table in a second. Any more discussion? All in favor? 4-0.
Okay, so the tentative closing date for the sidewalk grant will be December 20th. Leslie will be here, and that's, we've already gone through the audit. In there, you guys, in your packet was a letter from the state. We only had one minor setback, and that's been fixed. So we're scheduled for December 20th for that. And then final meeting of the year, do you want to have it December 27th? Do you want to have it December 29th? One's a Tuesday, one's a Thursday. We had to take the calendar down. Uh-huh. So Tuesday is the 27th, Thursday is the 29th. It'll be a special meeting. It'll just be for you guys to approve the encumbrances and to do all the final kind of stuff that you do at the end of the year.
Yeah, I'll do 29th at noon or something, or 29th at...
Do you want to do it at lunch? I mean, I'm perfectly...
I mean, or 1 o'clock. I don't know.
Or we could do it at nighttime. Thursday, I don't care.
Sure about that? I don't know.
It only takes... Keep the regular time.
Oh, yeah.
Whatever.
It only takes 5 minutes.
It doesn't take too long. Oh. It only takes like a good 30 minutes, maybe. And we're going to all have to be here. I have to be here.
Three
if you have to be here. It doesn't bother me what time on the 29th.
That's fine.
Doesn't matter to me.
Seven. So you're going to do it Tuesday? You do it? Yeah.
They said Thursday.
Thursday?
Thursday.
Yeah. 29th at 7.
Okay. Last thing is I just want to invite you guys to the Christmas lunch that the city's going to have on December 21st from 12 to 1. And it's going to be held at the annex, so then that way we don't have to remove vehicles and stuff. So.
At what time?
12 to 1.
At noon.
At noon. Okay. Over at the annex.
We're having prime rib.
Mm. We're having pulled pork and brisket and.
Did you say lobster?
No lobster. Mm-hmm. Apple and cherry cobbler. It's not going. It's a barbecue kind of style Christmas. Lunch, because that was the consensus. They didn't want the turkey and the ham.
Any other thing for Madonna? Moving on. Intern city superintendent.
For the last 2 years, we've built a budget up to do some repair work on the governor on the number 5 engine, the last engine that was, the last big engine that was put in, the OP that we put in 1981. The governor's getting wore pretty bad. We notice it the worst during a black start when we have to pick up load in the dark. We can't control the cycles, and we've tripped a couple of circuits back off because of it, and it's nothing more than age. The engine was a 61 model engine, and we've had guys work on it off and on, and so we'd like to update it to an electronic type governor. It has load shear capabilities to run with the Caterpillar, and get rid of the mechanical aspect of it. We have backup. We have a backup system at the plant where we have electricity all the time in order to work our controls and stuff until we get an engine on the board. But a new mechanical governor is over $30,000 plus a retrofit to get it in. It's only one place in the country, and that's Gearhart's out of Houston that does it. I've been working with Mike Smotter at Mid-States, and they can put an electronic on there, and we have the load share capabilities already in the panel board. It's just a matter of converting the engine and getting it to balance and run with the other one, and we can do it for just under $20,000. And like I say, we've budgeted the money for the last 2 years to be able to do it, so I just need to know if you'd allow us to do that. It'll also help the efficiency of the fuel and you know, brownouts, that kind of stuff. So,
what's the dependability of the electronics?
They've been building them since 1990. You can't even buy a brand new governor anymore, a mechanical one. All you can buy is electronics. Okay. And they're worldwide, so.
That includes all the setup fees and
everything? That's everything to put it in. And I've got it split up to where part of it will come out of repairs on equipment, and the other will come out on capital outlay. So we've got the money in there to do it.
Kevin, it'd be about like an old Lincoln idle arc, four-cylinder portable welder years ago when they had the mechanical governor on versus the newer motor.
It has fly weights on it, if you understand how a governor works, and as they pick up load, the weight comes out, it comes back in, they run in oil all the time. But over the course of almost 50 years now, why, they're wore and the pins are worn. We've had it worked on a few times, but it's just, it's about run its course. So
the old welders used to have a vacuum control on the vacuum regulator, and they done away with it with the electronics. Yeah. It's a whole different welder, I think.
Yeah.
Need a motion.
Yeah.
Or not.
How many years warranty does it have?
Gosh, I really don't know, Kevin. I can't tell you that. I mean, we've never had any problems with getting warranty work done on any of them, and it hasn't been, you know, we've never had any trouble with the one we have on the Caterpillar. It came out electronic brand new, and so the load share module went on with it when we put it in 2002. Mm-hmm. So all we're basically going to do is just piggyback another one in there so they'll run together and share the load. So, you know, electronics, I mean, they're either working or they're not. It's kind of one of those deals. I don't think there's probably going to be a lot of wearing out to it.
So, is it necessary to run that in a wintertime blackout or brownout?
That's the only engine we got we can start in a blackout. We had it designed that way.
Oh,
so
this the north
OP
wall?
On the north wall. Yeah, we started in the storm, in the sun. Well, anytime we have a storm, because it's easiest to put on.
The cat won't pick it up all at once.
No, it depends on the time of year, but most of the year, no. So, and then if we can get it back off there and put the Caterpillar on, then we will. But it's set to black start. It's the only engine in the plant that is. So
I'll move spend $20,000 on governor.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to put an electronic governor on the OP. All opposed? All in favor?
Since early fall, I've talked to several of you, not all of you. I've caught you at different times and visited with you about the possibility of leasing or buying a skid steer for a couple of reasons. One is we want to, the Unruh boys could have testified to if they were still in here, what kind of shape our alleys are in, and in most cases our loader and that stuff are too big to maneuver in there. And the other one is to be able, after I bought that little oiler, to be able to use it for street repair in the spring and the summertime, because it's so much, it has so much more versatility with different attachments and that stuff, to be able to use it in a small tight area and keep our loader out in a lot of cases. And so I went ahead and called Caterpillar, and I called White Star Wichita for Bobcat, and I got a 1 year. And when we first talked about it, we talked about just leasing it for a year. And after Bob and I had visited quite a little bit, he wasn't so comfortable with a lease because of the fact that you get it for 12 months and then it just goes away, and you get nothing back for what you spent. Which the lease is very lucrative. I mean, it's about $8,440 a year, which is about a third of what a contractor could lease one for. They give you about a 33% discount being a municipality over what they do for private. And the same way with the purchase price. So after we discussed this the other day, I called Steve Bonner up at First Bank, which we have our bucker truck and our digger truck through, and ask him about an outright buyout and purchasing it on 3 years or on 5 years. And I gave you a copy of what he gave me. The interest rate is dirt cheap, and it has a full 1 year warranty for front to back, everything on it, and then the next 4 years has a bumper to bumper warranty for all the drivetrain. So the drivetrain's completely covered. And at 5 years, you know, it'll be paid off, or at 3 years, it'll be paid off. And there's a chance that if you want to get rid of it at that time, that you could probably get most of your money back out of it. A new machine like this to a contractor is about $74,000. So we get a pretty good discount if you wanted to run it 3 or 4 years or 5 and sell it, you know, and do something different. You could do that. But I also have seen since we sold that stuff on Purple Wave that there are a lot of times that we can buy used attachments for a third to half of what new ones cost. And this would give us the ability when we start shooting oil and tearing up pavement in the spring to be able to put a broom on there, maybe a grapple fork for trees and that stuff and clearing alleys, that type of stuff. Its uses are unlimited. So the money that I figured on pulling, I wanted to pull $25,000 out of it. We have an encumbrance that we've carried for the last 2 years out of street department of $55,000 that we've not bought any material with, and we've just carried it over year after year. And so what I intended to do was take $25,000 off of that encumbrance and put a down payment of $25,000 on and finance 30 for either 3 or 5 years. The interest rate is a little over 2.4%. It's pretty cheap. So at the end of the contract, you'd still only spend a couple thousand dollars in interest, and depending on, you know, how much we use the machine, why it'd be pretty cheap to operate. So, but it gives us the ability to kind of give that old loader a rest too sometimes, and the maneuverability to get it in some of these alleys where we can't hardly get our trucks in, which hopefully this winter will get cleaned up. But it'd be a year-round machine that we'd use every day, but it'd be bought strictly out of street money. So
I put this. I had Jeff get this purchase, and I wanted you guys to see it. I mean, well, I don't know what your thoughts are on leasing equipment.
You know, just is it brand new. I guess I'm.
It's brand new.
Brand new.
Yeah, it's okay. Brand new. And if you lease it, they equip it totally, which is the way that one's equipped. And the reason is so that they have a saleable item at the end of that lease. But the retail on it, or the resale on it, it just makes it that much higher when you send it back anyway. And it makes it a year-round machine that way too.
Right.
So.
Was it tracks or tires?
Yeah, it's tracks. The one that I had figured through Caterpillar, their lease was cheaper with tires. But it was also about $3,000 higher a year than what this machine was. And we felt like that, you know, the years that Bobcat has made machines and the more breakdowns than we see, we think it's probably the better machine of the two anyway. And anytime we have any problems with this, they'll come out and pick it up for nothing, haul it in, take care of it, bring it back, and bring us a loaner machine while it's in. So
brand new wouldn't have any breakdowns.
Well, but you never know. I mean, you know, but then the next 4 years they're in the drivetrain with the drivetrain covered by, they'll still take care of it that way. Yeah. And his cost on the maintenance or on the drivetrain agreement was $5,200, or our cost was $5,200, and he said if you take it for the full 5 years he would give it to us for $4,400. So that's where I come up with about it ends up $29,600, you know. So right at $30,000, and there's no tax. It's a street piece of equipment, so there's no tax on it. So anyway,
is that got it's rubber tracks, correct?
Yes, 12-inch tracks.
Is that something that would be able to be used to remove the snow on the sidewalk that you can't get?
I think as long as it wasn't too heavy, we could, you know. I think the coverage on the ground is probably less, but we have a John Deere with a front rubber bit blade that we use on most of the sidewalk, but I'm not going to say it couldn't be. I think the weight difference compared to tires, you can kind of glide across them and you don't tear very much up. So,
of course, you may not get any snow.
May not. May not.
Well, like I said, I instructed Jeff to get the amount that it cost to buy one, just because I wanted you guys to see. if you chose to do something, I wanted you to have at least have.
I don't like the idea of leasing anything.
Have an option.
You know, for some guys, it probably works. I know, like the guy that does our safety meetings from KMU, they lease one, but they're kind of in a position where they're not going to put 50 hours a year on it. You know, we intend on using this machine. We're gonna jump in the spring. We're gonna start repairing some street. It's gonna get a lot of use.
I think you'll find out if you do lease a machine, you're only allowed $100 or 100 hours.
200 hours. 200 hours. No, 200 hours a year is all we're gonna get if we lease it. So, and this is unlimited. I mean, you know, we just use it. It'd be ours, and then if the time comes that we wanted to trade up or whatever, then we look at that point. But I don't see any reason, you know. Most of the equipment we got here, we keep 20 years.
Yeah.
We take good enough care of it that we keep it 20 years, so I don't see any reason why this would be any different.
Jeff, how much money are we saving being a municipality?
You save 33%. It's just under $75,000 to buy this if Kevin was to go in and buy it, the same machine. So they give you really, you know, in fact, it has to go clear back to the factory. The White Star can't even figure these. They get figured from the factory, and they send them out as to what they'll do. So.
Same way with buying a new Dodge pickup. For $23,000.
Yeah, same kind
of versus what it cost us $50,000.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So have you checked around any other skid steer?
The only banks?
Skid steer makes like John Deere.
I went to Kyle with Caterpillar. Those are the only two that I went to. We don't like the John Deere. I mean, there's just and we've talked to John's guys because they use them too, and they. And the reason that he bought them was they were less expensive this time around to do that. But the guys, you know, we used one a year ago. We've used Caterpillars a couple different times. But as far as the smoothness and the operability and the simpleness of this machine, we like this machine by far the best. And we thought with, you know, these guys, they're really good about taking care of you and maintenance-wise. And, I mean, if they'll come and pick it up and maintain it for nothing, why? You know, Bobcat's been in business a long, long time, and we just see very few breakdowns on them, and we don't abuse them. I mean, we use them, but we don't abuse them, and so we kind of felt like this was the best option for what we wanted to do. So,
add that looks to me like this is a high flow machine, and you can get an awful lot of attachments to go on the machine.
One thing that we've looked at doing, and we probably would grant it when it come that time, was to try and put it in the big ditch in the spring with a boom arm mower and try and straighten that big ditch up some. It's been an awful mess for years. It's hard to maintain, and this is a machine we can get in the bottom and straighten it out too and get it cleaned up. And hopefully we get on down the list of some other things I've got by the time we get some cleaning done and some of this other that we can start taking care of some of these problems, I hope. So.
It says at the bottom in handwritten ink there, 4,400.
Yeah, that's a powertrain warranty. That's a full front-to-back powertrain warranty. That, I added that on because I called him about that to make sure that we could get it covered. So that we had any mechanical type breakdown at all, that they would stand behind it. They're not going to fix the lights or the clock radio or anything like that, but they'll take care of the drivetrain. We'd be responsible for the wear on the tracks, just like anybody else would on tires and that stuff. But as far as mechanical function, they will take care of the mechanical function. So,
how long will the tracks last on the road?
Well, I guess it would depend on how much turning you do on the asphalt ball, would be my guess. He said they'll wear comparative to tires. You know, tires, they have a tendency to slide, I think, a little better on the asphalt than tires do. Tires have a tendency to skid. And so we think that we'll get quite a little bit of wear out of them. So,
I've never been around a track machine other than the one that you had over when we took that dirt.
Yeah. You'll never come up to it and have a flat tire.
Nope. That's right. That is a fact.
At 7 o'clock in the morning, yeah, the tires are reared up.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. I'm kind of in favor of not spending any more money this year, but
table it. Or
this is one that will go out if the encumbrance isn't used. That's the only reason I did it, was because the money's there, and at the end of December, the money will go away. And it's been carried 2 years, so that's the reason I brought it up now.
Well, we've got the money in the budget.
done that, I don't see a problem with getting it. I'm not a big fan of spending a lot of money, but if you've already budgeted for it.
It's carried 2 years. I mean, we haven't bought any material. We're hoping to buy material next spring and put it back on the street. But also, by the same token, we just think that this piece of equipment will just, you know, between an asphalt zipper and some other things, that we'll just, we can just go like a house of fire when it comes time to do the street stuff in the spring.
And this is the price right here.
That's the price, yeah.
Have you checked on any prices on used Bobcats, skid steers?
We can't get any kind of a bargain. We'd pay the same price you did.
I see.
It's way cheaper for us to buy. If you go to buy a 2014 machine, you'll pay more than that for it.
I see.
So
with the warranty, you're looking at $55,021.59. Is that right? Did I figure that right?
54, right at 55, 55, 21. And I was going to take that 25, like I said, out of that encumbrance money, and so you'd just be financing 30. So.
And then do you rent the broom, or you buy?
We can buy them. You know, like I told Bob earlier, I've noticed since we sold that stuff on Purple Wave that there's a few places that you can pick up some pretty reasonable used equipment, pretty cheap. I mean, if you saw on the second page, I priced a broom. But I've been watching two on Purple Wave that are brand new, that the last one that sold brought $1,300. And this one's $4,000. I mean, you know. And if you can pick up stuff like that, you can buy two or three pieces of used equipment that will last for the price of one piece of new. So, I just think I would rather put the straight bucket on there and then try and buy a few attachments. Just kind of watch them and see. This one place that I've watched, they've sold half a dozen new pieces of equipment at less than half price, and they've never been on a machine. So.
You want to table this till next meeting? Or you want to go out and think on it? You want to throw it out the door?
No, I mean, I think it's a great piece of equipment and it can be put to use. I wouldn't mind tabling it one more meeting if we could.
Still got another meeting by the end of the year.
Yeah.
Like 7:20?
We do.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's a bad deal.
Next thing, just wanted to tell you that we've repaired all the broken catch basins that we had torn up earlier this last month and got all the patches back in on the end of the sidewalk deal. All that stuff is done, and we saved quite a little bit of money by doing it ourselves, and we intend to keep doing some this winter that way too. So we'll do them as the weather permits.
I've noticed, guys, that I've been seeing a lot of concrete work done. I'm seeing some work get done around town.
Yeah, it looks good.
And yep. I'm not persuading you guys in any way, but you got to have equipment to do that. You
right.
know what I mean? You know.
How much are you probably saving on a catch basin?
Probably close to $3,000.
I was going to say, I think that he charges $4,000 or something like that
four.
For the one over there.
I think we've done four this fall. So.
Yeah.
Anyway. Next thing.
Electric service meters.
When we start changing these meters out, the electric meters, we're probably going to find 10 to 15% of these that are not up to code. And some of these people are not going to be able to afford this. The city's code says that they, you know, if for any reason we tamper with them or remove them, that they have to be updated for height and for material and everything else. And so I guess I want some guidance on what we want to do here. We're talking about 740 or 50 meters. So you're probably talking 75 to 100 that won't be in compliance. Some of those could be as easy as a disconnect. Some of them could be rigid conduit, disconnect, meter socket, you know, they could be $1,200-$1,500. You could get into a fairly large sum of money in a hurry that some of these people can't afford.
You know, some of it because the new meter won't fit the socket that's there?
Well, no, they'll all fit except for half a dozen. We probably got a half a dozen A-based meters. But you know as well as I do, you know, how many you guys have fixed for us in the last year that you terminate one and it's not up to code, whether it's flat wire or whether it's too short or, you know, whatever the case may be. No disconnect of any type, you know, and it's there for the safety of the customer as well as for the safety of the fire department and my guys and everybody else. But I guess I just want to know how far you want to push this. Because if the city was going to back up part of this financing, you could get into several thousand dollars and then deduct it back, you know, so much a month out of their light bill. But I mean, you could, and I'm sure that Kevin doesn't want to do 25 or 30 and have to eat 15 of them either, you know. I asked the guys from West Star, we went to school this fall, and I said, you know, what do you do? And they said, we just slap them in. Well, you can do that. But every once in a while, you can get into a pretty good jam. I mean, and the code does supersede what the National Electric Code says. The National Electric Code says within a reasonable distance. What the city code says is below the meter. So... But I don't feel that we can do it either because then we cheat private enterprise out of income too. So, you know, and then we stand a liability deal on top of that, trying to do any repairs to them too. I know the guys at Stafford went around and fixed something after hours, you know, but I don't think that's right. I mean, we require our contractors to have liability insurance, and that for that reason, you burn somebody's house down, why? They could be sitting at this table next Tuesday night. So... But we did our kickoff meeting on the meters today. We're going to see meters any day. So this is going to come about. It's going to come about fairly quick. We have a half a dozen or so, like I said, the old, what we call style A-base style meters that we'll wait until last to do. And there's probably a couple of those that might have a little trouble paying for them, but most of them have been warned in the past that we're going to change them. So... But it's just, you know, we don't have to do any action on it tonight, but it's something that you need to be aware of. That it probably will be a problem because we, you know, as soon as, I mean, they want this, when we start doing this, they want this done in pretty good fashion so that we get our all of our electronics up and running and everything working the way it's supposed to work. And it just drags it out when we have to stop for 10 or 15 or 20 of these that are not right. You know, in most cases, we could probably shove the meter in and we could say, well, you know, it needs to be updated within 30 days or 60 days, but then that you've lost your teeth on that deal too because you shoved the meter in. So.
And then these houses, the guys will still have to go walk manually.
Yeah, they still have to be read because once we do that, we can't send them into the system without putting a new electronic meter in them. So.
So it's kind of defeating the purpose of...
You know, could you send them the notice now?
We've told most all... You know, we haven't really taken account as far as meter books. Mm-hmm. We were just going to do it as we shoved them in. You know, the guys... Most of the guys that back the shop are not electricity savvy. So you really don't know what they're looking at on their meter books. So really only my guys are the only ones that really know what they're looking at. So, you know, And we're at the point right now where we're getting ready to raise a bunch of water lids and that stuff, and I really don't have time to send anybody out to do a head count. And unless you know what you're looking at, you know, whether it's just a disconnect or whether the mast has to go through the roof, or I mean, there's a lot of different scenarios to it. So it's all in, you know, how out of conformance they are.
I think that'd be some good thought process for a couple of electricians sitting at the table. You can see both sides of it pretty easy. I know there's a couple or three of us probably that don't really know what he's talking about.
Yeah. Well, I've got one that we're getting ready to terminate.
that looks like there's a disconnect there, but there's not.
Well, we did one up on the hill on Nutting last summer that was that way too, you remember? Mm-hmm. Same way they wired around the inside. I mean, unless you pull the lid on the box, you'll never know.
Yeah.
So, you know, and once we cut, it's always been the fact that if we terminated that service for a change of ownership, change of renter, non-payment, whatever the case may be, that meter did not go back in that socket until it was up to electric code. So, no ifs, ands, or buts. We didn't argue with anybody. We just didn't turn it back on because it wasn't safe. So,
could they be the last ones, and then we send them a notice?
I mean, you know, we could put them off. I'm going to guess 10 to 15%. I could be wrong. It could be 20. Well, it could be 25. I don't have a clue.
If you give them notice saying that
700 you know,
you've
meters,
got a month we can to fix it. If you don't fix it in the month, then
yeah,
we're going to switch it and we're going to shut you off until you do fix it.
I mean, it's kind of hard to do in January. That's kind of a rough way to get along with somebody. Especially if they don't have the money to do it, you know.
Right. Plenty of notice, you know.
Yeah, but I mean, you have to look at it, too, from the standpoint that they probably don't have the money to do it a lot of it.
Yeah,
that's the thing that we need to take into consideration, that not everybody has that kind of money to repair these kind of things.
Well, like you said, with a $4 deal on trash, imagine what would happen if they say, well, it's going to cost $800 to update that service.
Right.
You know.
You think people are going to be
talking about January or February? You can't just go over and pull their meter. I mean, you just can't do it.
Right? Yeah.
You have to have a little bit of decency to what you do. So.
Absolutely.
But then again, you have to think of the ones that do come up with the money to pay
for
it. Yeah,
well, I understand that.
So if you're going to do it for the ones that can't, then you're going to have to do it for the ones.
Yeah, you have to find. You could have to have it. You have to have it available for everybody. Yeah. You know.
And then you go back to the...
Yeah, I can afford it, but I'd rather pay you $20 a month than I would just drop $800, you know?
Exactly.
So then you start looking at, you know, 75 services if you're talking $800 a piece. Yep. You could easily have $30,000, $35,000 tied up here pretty quick, you know, and you're getting it back at $4 a month. It'll take a long time to get it.
And then you're going to get to the ones that... You already did make changes.
That are going to be really bent
really
out of shape.
That's really going to be bent out of shape because, oh, if I would have waited until the automatic meter and we're going to go in, you guys would have paid.
Which you're just guilty by association there, you know, because it could have been 2 years ago. But
I think
still,
Jeff and I have
but,
come up
but
with
you'll,
almost
you'll everything. Hear it anyway. It makes no difference. I mean, they're going to slap you in the nose any way you look. So, a couple more things. One, I'm going to have a guy come out and look about some doing some cleaning on some storm sewer catch basins and try and get some of it done before we start mapping in the spring so we get accurate heights on our GIS when we map it. Some of these have got, you know, quite a little bit of dirt in them and stuff and some of that, and then but at the same time I want to get a price from him. I think everybody sitting around the table understands that half the reason that we have backed up water in the spring and the summer is because they're full of dirt and have been for quite some time. And everybody just keeps shoving it under the table, but the fact remains that it's not going to get any better. And we get those big deep runs of water like we have a few times, like down there at the corner at First and Monroe. You know, I know of a couple of scenarios and a couple of cases where it went back in the guy's basement. You know, we've tried to stop that and try and control the traffic on it, but I think it's something that we're really going to have to address sometime this winter or in the spring. Is that the way the drainage system's laid out here in town, a lot of this stuff that's east of Broadway drains a block south of First Street, comes clear back across to the west part of town before it ever gets into the ditch. So it takes kind of a long way around to get there. And in some of those that we've had our heads in, we've got 18, 20-inch pipe that got that much dirt in them. And it doesn't seem to be washing away very fast. So anyway, I'm going to have him look at that and kind of give me a cost on trying. Maybe we do it over the course of 3 or 4 years. Maybe do a quarter of the town at a time. And then just I'll bring it back to you and kind of see what he says and see what you want to do there. The other thing I have is that we had, you'd allowed me last time to do something on the overhead door at the plant. We've had a little snag. The door company has changed hands. And they want half down to come down and even look and even order the door. And I got a little upset about it. I told him, I said, you know, we've dealt with the same guy up there for 25 years. We've never done this. Yeah. He said, we won't order it until we see half the money. So I called Sturdyville and had them come out and look. And their door is about $500 higher. But it's the best door that you can stick in there. And they're going to raise and lower the door the way that we want it. To get it up out of the way so we can still use our overhead crane. But I need your permission to make that change if I can.
Just need a consensus on that?
The cost of the
how
change.
How much is the cost?
$25,14.43.
Wasn't that going to come out of the...
It comes out of the Purple Wave money.
Yeah.
Yeah, where it comes from. But it's above my spending limit.
But it's above his spending limit. And last time you said as long as he stayed within his spending limit, he was okay. Otherwise, you
this door that they're going that they propose to put in is an R19 door. So it's probably in the best place in the world, being on the north side. So it'll stop as much cold air as we can stop. The other one was kind of a halfway deal. I wasn't very happy with the way they quoted it to me. And you can ask LaDonna. I got a little upset when he called me back. You know, I thought we'd done business with them. We, you know, we've done thousands of dollars worth of business with them. But
who? What door company?
Kansas Door.
Kansas Door.
Yeah.
Who are you?
So,
who's it? The new door from?
But it just really upset me when they did that, because I said, you know, we've always done things on a handshake. And it's not like you're going to get beat out of your mind. But they wouldn't budge. So
do we need to?
I said, well, if it's up to me. You just lost her, so.
Yep.
Yeah, I need
a motion.
I need a motion to do it.
I make the motion then. We'll allow Jeff to spend that money.
You got a motion on the table?
You got it.
And a second.
And a third.
All in favor?
Yeah, I just wanted it.
All opposed?
That's all I got. I dragged you for the last 30 minutes. That's all I got. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
City attorney report.
The only thing I have is also on our old business, the annexation of the shortstop. We have the consent. We're still having a little bit of issues with the legal one. I said,
there's nothing.
Okay. With the highway piece?
There's nothing at the county. There's nothing. At the, there's
nobody
nothing.
Had, no, not even
I
Randy.
Went,
nobody has
I
it.
Went to the county today, and I had Don George search.
Yeah.
And he came back, and he said, there is no right-of-way. There,
may
there is
have, there may
nothing
not be east
filed at the...
Did you talk to Randy?
At the DA.
I know I've not talked to him.
Randy told me, he said, there's nothing.
Every map... You oh, yeah. have, I went and pulled every map I could find, and there's nothing. There's nothing on it, except for
that little
for
strip of line down through the middle.
Right here, that says the east 1/4 corner, section 42. That's it. I even had Pam. Pam and I were
so
pulling
there's no
map.
Legal that sets the city boundary.
Nope.
Nope.
Not at all.
And Don George told me if Randy couldn't find it, it doesn't
it
exist.
It can't be found.
Exactly.
He's done this here for 40 years.
I think I probably need to come and look at the Livingston subdivision and the Dixon subdivision.
Yeah.
You can call Randy. Randy surveyed all of it. He can tell you.
And Don George pulled the plot maps.
It's not
the
there.
Official plot maps.
You guys may not exist.
We don't exist. We tried to tell you that once before.
And what Don George thinks has happened is when the state put in the highway or whatever that got done, nothing got filed.
Well, seeing on the one on the shortstop, it didn't get filed with the rest of them anyway.
Correct. And Randy agrees. He
because
said that's
Sherry and I owned that at that time, and they did everybody else's, and they left ours out, and they
right.
didn't even take that other 12 or 14
right.
feet off there.
We can do it one of two ways. Give me 2 weeks to figure something out. Otherwise, we can just go to the county, ask the commission to just jump the highway
yeah.
and annex the shortstop. We will have literally two separate
sections of city.
Ooh.
Not connected.
Yeah. Like anybody's going to
care. East St. John and West St. John.
Wow. Yeah, I love it.
It's possible. You just have to ask the county commission.
Be like Hutch. You know, you got South Hutch.
Yeah. It's like we've got South Eastboro Hutch. Edition.
Yeah. It's like we have Cassidy and Maxville over at Maxville. The track splits them.
It's stunning to me, but it's not.
I know.
It's not, I guess.
Just telling you. I searched around and around. And then I finally found them all in here. They're all in here, and now they're in a box.
I'm not sure what that means, because the police, I think, are enforcing that southbound traffic, and I'm not sure what gives them the authority then.
They carry a deputy card. That's what gives them the authority. They carry a deputy card to the county. So they can write tickets out there. They've done it for years.
I went today. I went. Nita and I pulled the plot maps, and then we went to Don George, and then Don George went to the attorneys.
Yeah, no joke. Exactly. We thought that 2 weeks ago, John.
Let's not drag it out.
I can just hear it go. Cha-ching, cha-ching, cha-ching.
All those tax dollars for the first year.
Yeah.
I had Pam and I, we even found the first ordinance for the city today. I found it. Ordinance number one. Didn't find anything about the city.
That's great. Mm-hmm. And it says urban boundary on it. That's what it says on the highway. Doesn't say city limit, it says urban boundary. Yeah. Always has.
And so Don agrees with Randy. When they did all that, they didn't file it.
No.
Okay, we'll figure something out.
Yeah. We'll paint a line across it. Just call it.
Anything else, John? That's it. Okay, that brings us to new business.
Annexation of the land, Axman's land donation and sidewalk project. Do we want to take that completely off? Do we want me to keep saying, hey, we're going to table it and talk about it next time? What do you want to do with the Axman sidewalk project?
To Dollar General.
Yeah.
To Dollar General. I don't care.
Bye.
Oh, we can't just, now that we got it appraised there, or a survey, you can't just put it in there?
Well, sure, we could put it anywhere you want to. If you want to, if you want to spend the money and do it.
Well.
Really, the only right thing to do, probably as far as we're concerned, is to just put a fence across the back at Dollar General and call it good. Without spending the money on the sidewalk. But, I mean, that's up to you guys. I mean, we didn't see any place else that it would be feasible to put a sidewalk through there that we wouldn't take a chance of running trucks over. If we have to get in on that line or anything, you know.
But you would drive between the orange stakes.
I could, yeah. I'd have to
put a sidewalk needs to be
on the west side
of the poles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's where it need to be.
Yeah. And we pay $15,000. Dollar General's going to pay roughly $50,000.
Well, I haven't seen it in writing, but right. Yes. I haven't seen it in writing. I have just heard. That's just what I've heard.
Find out what Dollar General's going to do and how much the fence is going to cost.
Yeah. I mean, really, in order for us to get in there, we'd have to put a culvert in that ditch, and we really only have an easement. We don't have an alley.
Right.
So, you know.
Yeah. I mean, with...
Chances would be slim and none we'd ever need to get in there, but if we have to change a transformer or whatever, yeah. You know, we'd still have to get in there.
I'll table it.
But could you get with Carolyn and ask her to have to get that in writing?
I'd pay for the whole thing.
Well, if they want people to go there, Mansell's whole bid included Axman's and bringing the sidewalk all the way up here to
the side of the
annex building, which. I don't know if the county's very happy about that, but I mean that's just another topic. But when Carolyn talked to Dollar General, she gave the grand total. She just didn't give the total for
the east edition.
For the east part. Mm-hmm. So if they actually give $15,000, they're actually probably going to pay for all of the east side, and we would just pay for the west side. That would be my thinking of it, but. I'll get with Carolyn.
Okay.
Now we're ready for our executive sessions.
Okay. In motion.
Do you want to do a 15-minute one to include all three?
You want to do
I think we just need to do everything.
Yeah, all three.
Yeah,
yep. They're all three same topic. And then Jeff and Sherry would probably have to leave for the city superintendent.
I think you just note on the record that halfway through the executive session.
Then we bring Sherry back and Jeff back for the rest of it.
Unless you want to do...
I don't care.
It, whatever way you want to do it, you just put on the minutes that she left during
That's what I already have on the minutes.
Oh, okay.
I'm still here.
I know, but I figured you're going to
need a motion.
We need a motion.
So move.
Second. We got a motion and a second. All in favor? 3-0, 4-0
You want the gunfight?
Is there going to be anything left there, Jeff?
27.
I bet you could take some.
42.
You want some of that. That's what Kevin's saying.
42.
Okay. Your napkin.
You want me to leave now?
Yeah, you guys leave now, and then I'll bring you back.
I'll leave now. Sure, I will.
Jeff, what have you heard about the.
The compensation, last year they got a compensation across the board of $100 for all full-time city employees. Do we want to continue that so I can get the check ready or not?
I was content with the two full paid days off.
Well, it's really one because they already get the one for the 26th. It's just an extra paid day off.
I don't have a problem with what we did last year.
We need to appreciate them.
Yeah, okay. I think all of our city employees, they do a heck of a job.
I think I need a motion, right? I need a motion.
So move then.
Second.
We got a motion and a second on the table to give $100 Christmas bonus straight across the board for city employees. Any more discussion? All in favor? All opposed? Passes 3-4. And one against.
Okay. I need a motion to adjourn.
I need a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Got a motion and a second.
Second.
All in favor? We got one guy who wants to spend the night.